From A&E, this is Biography.
Brian is alone. His music is alone, and no one can create music like Brian.
The feel was right, the notes were right, the harmonies were right.
Imagine not only writing all that material, but defining California mythology.
The music spoke to us because he was one of us.
His insight was absolutely incredible.
He was like Atlas Shrugged, you know, he had to hold up the world. That's what he was doing each time he made a project.
Mozart probably had his problems too.
God only knows what I'd be without you.
On a sunny morning in 1913, water czar William Mulholland dedicated the new Los Angeles Aqueduct, designed to bring water to the arid basin. He gestured to the desert below and declared, "There it is, take it." In a city that invented itself, people came to reinvent their lives. While Hollywood idealized life in California, generations of migrating Midwesterners came to live it. The Wilsons were one such family. Murray and Audrey Wilson shared a love of music and a hope for a better life than their parents. He was a moonlighting songwriter. She was a homemaker. Brian Douglas Wilson was born June 20th, 1942, a healthy baby with wide hazel blue eyes. Brother Dennis came soon after in December 1944. Murray and Audrey put down $2,300 for a small two-bedroom house in Hawthorne, the city of good neighbors. A third son, Carl, arrived in December of 1946.
It was Ozzie and Harriet. It was a post-World War II housing tract. It was a type of home that I grew up in. You know, that's why I could relate. That's why our generation could relate to Brian and his music.
Southern California is a young area with young thinking and modern planning.
By day, Murray worked in Hawthorne's top industry, aviation. His songwriting aspirations peaked when band leader Lawrence Welk played Murray's composition Two-step, sidestep on his weekly radio show.
In that household, you'd have Audrey, who was an absolutely beautiful person, on the organ, and Murray sitting at the piano, crooning out melodies in his very, you know, brusque voice. He'd go, doo, doo, doo. You know, he'd be doing the singing, these melodies, and he just was impassioned by music.
As a father, Murray played dictator. Disobedience was often met with a blow or a humiliating punishment. He once tied Brian to a tree for misbehavior. The boys quickly learned that their father's soft spot was music. As a child, Brian had loved the music of George Gershwin. As a teenager, he discovered the Four Freshmen, whose jazz harmonies he spent hours dissecting.
I used to teach him Four Freshmen harmonies like,
"It's a
My dad, my mom, and Carl and I, and Dennis wasn't good enough to, he was too stupid to learn. But the four of us would just sit there and just harmonize, and we loved it."
Murray and Audrey took the boys on trips to the newly opened Disneyland, billed as the happiest place on earth. Brian loved riding the Matterhorn and eating the peanut brittle on Main Street. As they grew, the boys' personalities emerged. Carl, the baby of the family, was sweet and introverted. Dennis was the rambunctious troublemaker whom neighbors dubbed Dennis the Menace. Brian was special. He was deaf in one ear, some said from a blow by Murray. Still, he had a gift for music.
He was always the person who sang. And then some people who
went to a certain church, heard him, and they thought he was wonderful. He was.
Murray obviously recognized early on how gifted Brian was as a little boy and made sure that whatever lessons they could afford, Brian got, made sure that whatever equipment Brian needed, he had.
At Hawthorne High, Brian was a decent student and a competitive athlete, center fielder in baseball, and a quarterback who could throw a football 65 yards. Classmates found him shy, sweet, and goofy.
Brian's way of communicating with people was through his humor, as well as through his music. His biggest gift to somebody was to get him to laugh or to play him a song on the piano in later years in high school.
I think if you look at the picture of Brian on Senior Ditch Day, you sense immediately that he was apart from the group and yet at the same time wanted to be part of the group. And that almost sums up his experience with the Beach Boys.
Hawthorne Boulevard was one of Los Angeles's great cruising streets, running six lanes wide. Brian patrolled the streets in his most prized possession, a 57 Ford Fairlane that Murray had given him. Brian also loved singing and laughing with his cousin, a cut-up named Mike Love. In years to come, their vocal blend would become the core of Brian's music.
There's a story told of a very gentle boy and the girl who wore his ring.
He heard the intricate harmonies there and the beauty of that type of singing. Blew his mind. He came home every day from school and practiced that.
For their hearts were full of spring.
Something like that, I think, is a gift from God, really. I mean, the sound of their voices together. It's a singular instrument.
He approached it almost like a prayer, a moving prayer, in the sense that we think of prayer as something sacred and silent, but a joyous prayer, something like almost gospel.
In the fall of 1960, Brian enrolled at El Camino Junior College, where he became reacquainted with Alan Jardine, a fellow Hawthorne Cougar, and another fan of the Four Freshmen records.
And he just pore over these recordings until he got it as close as he could on the piano. And then he'd call me up, and mostly to just cut our teeth, testing the water, see where we could go vocally.
We're full. Spring.
Youngest brother Carl loved rhythm and blues music and tried to convert Brian.
And he's going, hey, listen to this, Brian. Listen to this. And then you hear this. Hey, baby, ain't running around tonight. Hey, mama's got a baby. Mama's had a baby tonight. You know, and I thought, what is this? You know. And a couple years later, I said, oh, I see.
Brian's 16-year-old brother Dennis had become more of a truant than student, spending most of his time at the beach, 6 miles west of Hawthorne. Mother Audrey insisted the boys include Dennis in the group. Although he couldn't play an instrument, he became the drummer. In August of 1961, Murray arranged an audition with a mom-and-pop publisher in Hollywood. They loved the harmonies, but thought the boys needed an image. Dennis mentioned his latest pastime.
He told me, he said, we should write a song about surfing. And then Mike goes, bop, bop, dip, and I go, it fell together so fast you wouldn't believe it, made our heads swim. I mean, our heads were swimming.
Okay, guys, slay it, this will be take one, surfing.
Surfing is the only life, the only way for me. Now surf, surf.
Brian and Mike wrote the song over Labor Day weekend, and by Thanksgiving had a single on a small L.A. label. They called themselves the Pendletons. But when the 45s were pressed, they found their name had been changed. The first time the boys heard the song on local station KBLA, Carl got so excited that he threw up. Dennis called it the all-time moment.
Oh, it was a thrill. Are you kidding? I was out of my mind. I went out of my mind. I was so thrilled.
Surf, surf with me.
Murray Wilson appointed himself manager and ferociously set about promoting and molding the Beach Boys. He tried to get his son to surf for the band's image, but Brian refused. He was afraid of the ocean. For Brian Wilson, it would always be about the music.
All right, let's really have the Azusa Teen Club welcome now for these young fellows from California with their big new hit. Here they are, the Beach Boys with Surfin' Safari.
Let's go surfing now, everybody learn how. Come on a safari with me.
Brian Wilson and the Beach Boys had a single on the charts before they had ever played a show. They knew they had to look like surfers.
Brian and I actually went down and bought the first uniforms, which were Pendleton shirts, down at Macy's, down at Del Amo Shopping Center. And our little uniforms kind of kept us together.
In 1962, Al Jardine left the band to study dentistry. 13-year-old Hawthorne neighbor David Marks was brought in on rhythm guitar until Jardine's return 1 year later. Impressed by the Kingston Trio's clean-cut image, father and manager Murray Wilson went to J.C. Penney's and bought the band 24 candy-striped shirts.
When they were clean-cut looking, they looked like they just came from Disneyland or Catalina, you know.
Following Murray's unique promotional strategy, the Beach Boys played sock hops in radio stations across Southern California for free. The boys filled out their set with Chubby Checker songs and instrumentals. Meanwhile, Murray worked hard at getting a deal with a major label.
And Murray was a very, very complex person, but he was a good person. And I think, had he not been the manager in the early years, that the boys probably wouldn't have survived the early years.
Capitol Records saw surfing music as the fad of the moment, but their youngest producer, 21-year-old Nick Benet, heard something special in the demo of Surfin' Safari. By September, the Beach Boys had a top 40 single and Capitol was clamoring for more. Murray demanded absolute control and was suspicious of outsiders. Brian, however, had started writing songs with Gary Usher, 24-year-old who had heard the band practicing in their Hawthorne garage. Usher took his girlfriend to see the boys play in a Hollywood coffee house.
Gary said, "Do not laugh at Brian if he starts to sing falsetto." I said, "Why not?" He said, "He's very self-conscious about it, and he's trying out this song, Surfer Girl." So we're listening, and Brian sings, and somebody in the audience started to laugh. They got very uptight about it, Brian. I feel kind of funny, they're laughing at me. I said, "They're not laughing at you, they've just never heard anything so great before."
Brian had started dating his first real girlfriend, an outgoing blue-eyed brunette named Judy Bowles. To Brian's friends, she was the surfer girl. Brian had given her an engagement ring when he started community college. Now a budding pop star, his future with Judy faded. In the studio, Capitol's Nick Benet was assigned to shepherd the group, but Murray insisted he could do a better job. He hounded Benet with suggestions, who took to hiding under his desk when Murray entered the building.
Murray, in the beginning, was always on the sessions, and he wanted to be the producer. And unfortunately, he wanted to produce records like it was in the 40s.
Murray often tried to force his sons to sing material he had written, but Brian, more than anyone else, knew what the kids liked.
Catch a wave and you're sitting on top of the world.
Each weekend, 30,000 surfers crowded Southern California's beaches. More than a sport, surfing celebrated youth, sun, and sex. Dennis enjoyed the footloose life of the surfer. He regaled Brian with stories of wild times and sexual exploits.
Just not anybody can go out in 6-foot surf, you know. And Dennis Wilson did it. He was the real beach boy, but Brian captured the energy of the waves, you know.
It has to sound like Cars, Girls, and Surf. You can't just sing about it. Because a lot of people sang about Cars, Girls, and Surf and didn't do what they did.
Here's the deal. As a surfer, and I still surf, the Beach Boy music was the Hollywood version of what the beach should be.
For true blues surfers, the Beach Boys were a joke. They listened to R&B and jazz.
We hated all the Hollywood crap. We hated all the, you know, those guys, when I had my shop, they'd send the, you know, the Beach Boys would send music to us, and we'd say thank you very much, and the minute they'd leave, they'd go in the trash.
Most surf music was instrumental and often used to underscore popular surfing movies. Guitar legend Dick Dale played to sell-out crowds weekly at the Rendezvous Ballroom in Newport Beach. Countless other surf bands emerged from garages across Southern California. Although they weren't really surfers, the Beach Boys were young Americans who understood the freedom of a transistor radio or a set of wheels. They spoke that language perfectly. The funniest sound I ever heard. In October of 1962, Ginger Blake brought her two cousins to see her new favorite band at Pandora's Box on the Sunset Strip.
There was no real coordination. It was just getting up there like a jam. And they would even eat hamburgers on stage. You know, they would tell us, could you please go get us a hamburger?
They were truly naive, and we were naive as well. We were all quite young. Their sole purpose was to sing.
You know, like they finished the song, they said, hey, can I have a sip of your hot chocolate? I went, okay, you know. And he takes it and he spills it all over me by accident. It was very funny. It was kind of like our first introduction.
The girls wanted to form a singing group. Brian offered to produce them. They picked the name The Honeys from a Beach Boys lyric. Jewish girls from Hollywood didn't date Protestants from Hawthorne, but something about the meeting of the two worlds worked. While the Beach Boys' popularity exploded on a national level, Brian retreated into the safe haven of his music.
There's a world where I can tell my secrets to in my room.
As manager and father, Murray Wilson continued to play drill sergeant to his sons. His motto, fight for success.
Brian didn't know how to react to him other than take it all inside and just be frustrated and hurt and insecure. And his father just made him feel very insecure.
For those of us that know what that's like, growing up in a home like that, you have a safe place that you can go and you play your guitar, or you go in there and you hide, or you do things. And I think in my room says an awful lot.
After a fight with Murray, 21-year-old Brian moved out of the house. He and a roommate found a sparsely furnished apartment in nearby Inglewood.
He didn't want to be held back in his creativity, and I could understand it. And it was hard, I think, for Murray to allow that.
Brian spent more days at recording sessions in Hollywood and more nights at Marilyn's home, where her parents welcomed him as the son they never had.
I mean, he was fascinating and funny and eccentric and outrageous. And all they did was laugh. They got such a kick out of him.
It was a treat because it was the first time I'd ever really was taken into a house, you know, and say, look, you can sleep with my daughter if you want, you know. It was like, it was all so like a fairy tale.
you got this dad, Murray, who's really doing what a dad should do. You know, don't hang out in Hollywood with the phonies. Get home, get to bed early. You know, stay humble, Brian.
For Murray, a frustrated songwriter of limited talent, the music business meant war. For his son, making hits came naturally. Now, atop the charts, Brian Wilson was being drawn into the battle. When Brian Wilson heard Be My Baby, his life changed.
The night we met, I knew I needed you so.
I like the melody.
So won't you say you love me?
Be My Baby was the creation of a wunderkind producer from Fairfax High in Hollywood, Phil Spector. Spector was who Brian wanted to be, a master producer and songwriter, the tycoon of teen. In the studio, both Capitol Records and father Murray Wilson tried to call the shots. But Brian's vision made the music work. He became the producer.
No, well, yeah, actually, I actually set out to try to Be My Baby. I actually did in my head. I knew I couldn't, but I tried to anyway, you know what I mean?
Well, it's been building up inside of me for, oh, I don't know how long.
Brian started using Phil Spector's session musicians, nicknamed the Wrecking Crew, and recorded in the same Hollywood studio.
But she looks in my eyes.
Brian's a natural-born producer. I mean, he's the prototype of what you have so predominantly in today's music. That's the person who writes the song, has the vision, writes the song, produces it, and can perform, play, and sing. I mean, Brian was that guy.
It's not about sitting there planning, I'm going to write a hit now to be rich and famous. He needs to get this force out of him.
And all of his music has been about bringing love to an audience. And I think that came about because he was using music to bring love to himself.
Brian's first number one song was not with the Beach Boys, but with a tune he'd thrown together with Jan and Dean, Surf City. Murray saw it as high treason, but Brian always liked working with outside acts, especially his girlfriends.
We never gave him any hassle. We just did what he told us, because hey, who are we? What do we know? All we know is this guy is just wonderful.
Brian's love of studio work underscored his growing hatred of touring.
Brian was an introvert in an extroverted industry. He didn't need the roar of the crowd and the smell of the grease paint. You know, Mike did. And I'm sure Denny did, and I'm sure the other guys did to a degree, but Brian didn't need that.
The one time Murray didn't play tour chaperone, he heard reports of drunkenness and venereal infections. He tried to impose order.
For instance, Murray would come out on the road with us and be the manager. Bad idea. Don't want Dad out on the road. You don't want him in your face. You don't, you know, particularly telling you when and where to be at, you know, and fining you if you're late. We hated the fines. We didn't like that fine system.
Murray appointed himself president of the Beach Boys Publishing Company and continued to bully Brian in the studio.
Fellas, I have 3,000 words to say. Brian, I'm a genius too. Let's go, huh? What's the matter? You made too much money, buddy? When you guys get too much money, you start thinking you're going to make everything a hit.
We would like to record under an atmosphere of calmness.
I love you, my mother loves you. Chuck and I used to make one hit after another in 30 minutes.
Times are changing.
You know why? Because you guys think you have an image.
Times are changing.
Don't ever forget.
Times are changing.
Yeah. Honesty is the best policy, son.
Murray just wanted to express himself musically, and maybe he just envied the fact that it came so easily to Brian, but I don't think he was jealous.
Yes, I think Murray was jealous of Brian.
Brian finally stood up to Murray. In the spring of 1964, after yet another fight, he fired his father as manager. Murray Wilson took to his bed for weeks, depressed. For many, the Beach Boys were America's greatest hope against a coming invasion.
You couldn't open a door, get in a car or out of a car without being hit in the head by the Beatles. I mean, from Brian's perspective, this must have been a total man in crisis, which of course produces either tragic or comic results.
When the Beatles came along, Brian, you have to admit, there was a little bit of
competition. Oh, I was jealous as hell. I was so jealous. Were you jealous?
No, I wasn't. I was in awe.
Brian Wilson found the music of the Beatles fresh and challenging. The competitive streak Murray had instilled in him took over. The stream of hits seemed endless. In addition to writing odes to root beer, school spirit, and drive-ins with Mike Love, Brian had taken to writing car songs with collaborators like disc jockey Roger Christian.
Brian's knowledge of cars bordered on zero. We all borrowed our dad's car. We all cruised the boulevard, whether it was in Albuquerque or Salt Lake or Sacramento or Hawthorne, California.
Basically put California on the map as a tourist industry. I was thinking, what's that worth, you know? Maybe he should just get royalties from the state of California.
And I think he captured the optimism, the hope, the dreams that were America, but through the California vision seemed to have a unique perspective of.
It was fascinating to see Brian Wilson in the 60s personifying this California sense of place, which all Americans used as their dream escape.
In 1963 and 64, the Beach Boys released 16 hit singles and 7 albums. Brian composed almost all the music. With their first number one hit, I Get Around, the Beach Boys could no longer be dismissed as just another surf band. But Brian's lyrics hinted at a new direction. Twenty-two-year-old Brian still toured with the band, but the road kept him from the security of home and the joy of recording music. In November of 1964, on a flight to Australia, Brian suffered a panic attack. He had the pilot wire Marilyn that he loved her. Although she was still only 16, they got engaged. Brian wrote to her daily.
Marilyn, wonderful. That's how he did it. Marilyn, wonderful. You're now 81 and I am 87, but we still look the same to each other. I love you more each day, Marilyn. You didn't know me when I was Brian the neurotic, but there was another way for me to obtain it, through music, my world of music. Honey, I was out of it. No one needed music like I did. Hours at the piano. I was a starving child. Through an act of God, a blessing in its most beautiful way, I was saved from a life of misery. You are the last of the real persons. Yours till God wants us apart, Brian. It's a nice letter, huh?
Weeks later, on December 7th, Brian and Marilyn were married in a civil ceremony. By Christmas, Brian Wilson would have his first nervous breakdown. Brian Wilson hated to fly. On December 23rd, 1964, he left for Texas to begin another Beach Boys tour. Mid-flight, he fell to the cabin floor, screaming and sobbing. His bandmates tried to comfort him, but he was inconsolable.
I never saw it as a nervous breakdown, but they all called it a nervous breakdown. And he just knew that he could not go on the road. That was not his thing. And the truth is, he was right.
When Brian flew back to Los Angeles, he asked his mother to pick him up at the airport by herself.
And when I arrived there, Brian was standing waiting, and he dashed out to the car. He was sobbing. Oh, that was such a tough time. And I said, "Where do you want to go?" And he said, "Hawthorne." So I took him there.
Session guitarist Glenn Campbell replaced Brian on tour.
Mike Love and Carl said, "We want you to play bass and sing Brian's part." And I went, "Wow, I don't even know the words." They said it won't matter because it's so loud anyway. You know, I can do the part, you know.
Brian told the rest of the band he could no longer travel. He would stay home and produce hits. Mike and Al got teary. Dennis threw furniture. Only Carl saw that it could all work out.
Help me, Ron, help me, Ron. Help me, Ron, help me, Ron. Help me, Ron, help me, Ron. Help me, Ron.
18-year-old Carl became the band's leader on stage, a role he maintained for the next 30 years. Brian only performed on special television appearances.
Get her out of my heart.
Brian and Marilyn moved into a Hollywood apartment. Although it was only 12 miles from Hawthorne, it felt a world away. Murray was upset with his son for quitting the road. Although his father no longer managed the band, Brian continued to seek Murray's approval.
And we would go out there and he would play it for his dad, and his dad would listen and give his opinion, and then they wind up in a fight again because his father would give his opinion, but that's really not what Brian wanted to hear.
Murray had always accused his wife of undermining his authority with the boys. Audrey often took solace in alcohol. The couple separated in 1965, but moved into neighboring homes. Murray turned his attention to creating his own surf band, the Sun Rays.
He admired all of them deeply, and especially Brian. And he wanted somehow to have a relationship with his sons and with his wife, but he only knew how to do it on his terms. And sometimes his terms didn't have enough sensitivity to be able to get through to them.
And Murray still was trying to control him like a young kid. And Murray and Brian had a pretty violent argument. Murray told him that he would never be a man. And Brian ripped his glasses off and threw the glasses on the ground and broke them and said, I'm more of a man than you'll ever be, and jumped in his car.
When I grow up to be a man, will I dig the same things that turned me on as a kid? Will I look back and say that I wish I hadn't done what I did?
And he questioned whether or not he was enough of an adult, you know. And he did want to become a more substantial, adult, self-controlled kind of person.
By 1965, the Los Angeles music scene had exploded. The Sunset Strip was lined with go-go clubs, and the Hollywood Hills filled with late-night parties.
There was a lot of cross-pollination back in L.A. in the 60s with the Beatles and the Beach Boys and the Birds, and a lot of ideas that got borrowed and recycled in different ways.
Brian met the music industry's in-crowd. They introduced him to drugs. In early 1965, he tried LSD for the first time. When Marilyn saw Brian the next morning, he said, "I saw God," and broke down crying.
And he was unable to stop. And I think that it, you know, medicated his pain. You know, I mean, deep inside, he was insecure and in pain and unsure of himself.
Marilyn left Brian when he refused to stop taking drugs. After a month, he begged her to come back. Together, they bought a home in Beverly Hills, which they decorated with 60s prints and lava lamps. Brian continued to smoke pot.
and I heard the beginning of California Girls, and that was the first time I went, well, because to me that the introduction to that song was kind of the start of a different sound.
Well, East Coast girls are hip, I really dig those styles they wear.
California Girls became an anthem to youthful lust and the group's biggest moneymaker. Surf music veteran Bruce Johnston was brought in as a permanent replacement for Brian on the road. He also sang in the studio.
Brian still thinks that we didn't sing it very well because our rhythm was just a little out of sync with the quarter notes. You know, I wish they'd... Oh, he still doesn't like it.
Bruce Johnston later complained about their image, saying, "The public thinks of us as surfing Doris Days." Brian, too, felt trapped by the striped shirts.
Hey, maybe you guys would like to join our club. We really turn on, man.
Yeah, surfing club, huh? That sounds real cool. Yeah, what are the dues?
$17.50 a year.
$17.50? What does that include?
Well, to start with, you get an emblem to put on your surfboard, daily surfing reports, and a chenille string so you can drive between your toes.
The Beach Boys had a surprise number two hit with Barbara Ann, a silly song that they had thrown off the cuff to fulfill a contractual obligation. The label wanted more of the same, but Brian had come too far artistically to repeat himself.
The growth was so amazing to me, but you know, they wanted Barbara Ann 20 more times, and you know, they would pull on Brian to get more commercial, get more commercial.
The idea that Brian Wilson was Mozart in Hawthorne was unbelievable. It just didn't make sense.
Reluctantly, Capitol indulged Brian's desire to produce a new type of album.
He said, "I just want to make the best album that was ever made." And he had this inside of him to do that.
Twenty-three-year-old Brian Wilson looked within himself to make a different kind of music.
Wouldn't it be nice if we were older, then we wouldn't have to wait so long? And wouldn't it be nice to live together in the kind of world where we belong?
As a lyricist for the album Pet Sounds, Brian chose Tony Asher, a 24-year-old advertising jingle writer.
He said, I want to write with you, hoping that this will be, you know, a successful collaboration, because all the people I've written with before are just going to write the same kind of stuff, and I want to do something very different.
Rock critic Nick Cohn described Pet Sounds as sad songs about loneliness and heartache. Sad songs even about happiness.
You could just write maybe the bridge. Wouldn't it be nice? That would be an accomplishment for most writers for a lifetime. Just the bridge.
Maybe if we think and wish and hope and pray it might come true. Run, run, you. Baby, then there wouldn't be a single thing we couldn't do.
And he just grew. I mean, he got better and better musically all the time, you know. And I think with Pet Sounds, he was trying to knock somebody out.
But wouldn't it be
was like, I want to create the best for everyone to hear and enjoy as much as I write it. And the way I write it, I want people to hear and feel this beauty. That's where he comes from when he makes his music. It's not just to be great.
While the Beach Boys toured Japan, Brian recorded the album's instrumental tracks with his usual group of musicians, the Wrecking Crew.
One more. Right there, don't move. Don't move. All right, let's make it. Here we go. Sloop John B.
We come on the Sloop John B. My grandfather and me. Around Nassau Town we did roam.
There
never showed up with the joggers and the riding crop. Everything was always totally egalitarian. Everybody, he was the first among equals.
I wanna go home.
Like watching a magician and trying to figure out how he's doing the trick, it turns into magic. There is no trick, you just can't be done.
When I used to play a lot of bebop, we would see each other on the street and go, bebop, ding dong, ding dong, you know, somebody, and we knew what we were saying to each other. We didn't need words to talk. Now, Brian is that very same way.
And that was a beautiful bass sound on that D thing. It was just perfect. Julius, that's a real kind of a tough thing to swing into, you know? Here we go, from the top. Sounds groovy.
To promote Pet Sounds, the Beach Boys hired the Beatles publicist, Derek Taylor, who made sure the right people wrote about the music. The rest of the band often resented their portrayal as the unwitting messengers of Brian's genius.
His blessing and his curse is he's a genius. And if I were a genius, I'd hate to have anyone tell me that.
I'm not sure that the genius tag is something that has been a weight around Brian's neck as much as it's been a weight around all of our necks in relation to how we perceive Brian and create what we're creating about Brian.
I mean, he turned his back on his whole world, including his band's world, to create his own vision of music, to give people something that we still have today. So I'm just saying that's not genius, that's just guts.
Most nights, Brian found his muse getting stoned. Before writing lyrics, Asher and Wilson had long conversations about life and love.
Where did your long hair go? Where is the girl I used to know?
He was trying to resolve a lot of issues for himself. You know, a lot of questions about whether he had made a mistake by getting married, because he cared a lot about Marilyn, but also it was terribly attracted to all these other women that he would see.
Who took that look away?
Joyous music has nothing to do with how joyful it was making the music.
And he put his heart and soul into that. Sat up in that bedroom, in that bed, listened to everything, and we're both hysterically crying throughout the whole album. Just crying.
Break my heart, I don't want to go cry. It's so sad to watch a sweet thing cry.
And it fades. And I'm speechless. Brian says, "What do you think of it?" And I said, "Brian, that's the most incredible record you've ever made." And Brian says, "What do you think the guys will think of it?"
They didn't like it. Mike said, "Gee, you know, it's too much of a departure." I said, "But Mike, I gotta do it this way for just one album." He goes, "All right, one album." I made a deal, we shook hands, that one album. And that was Pet Sounds.
Mike Love called it Brian's ego music and found some of the lyrics nauseating.
Because Brian and Mike were always pretty much, you know, having this little dance. You know what I mean?
Mike was the band's front man, but Brian asserted control in the studio. Vocal sessions were strained.
And they didn't know I was even there. And they'd say things like, you know, "I don't know why we're recording these stupid songs anyway," or whatever, you know. And I thought, why am I sitting here listening to that? I don't need to.
And God only knows what I'd be without you.
Pet Sounds made it to a respectable number 10 on the charts. But compared to previous Beach Boys records, it was a disappointment.
What do they say? Happy songs sell records, sad songs sell beer.
Mike, to his credit, understood what the music was not, and what it was not was more of the same.
Capitol Records failed to embrace Brian's new musical direction. 8 weeks after the release of Pet Sounds, they stocked record stores with a greatest hits album. In England, Pet Sounds was hailed as an instant classic. Paul McCartney and John Lennon said the album inspired their work on Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Undeterred by the tepid reaction at home, Brian stepped up his creative energy.
It was just an absolute mind-boggling event and so exciting to be around. And totally generated by this one force. And it was just him just moving by himself doing this.
Even the people that weren't depending on it, he felt they were depending on him. And he would feel that if he failed, everybody else failed.
Brian Wilson's four-year evolution had created a pop music revolution. His next song would be the 24-year-old's crowning achievement and also prove his undoing. In 1966, Ronald Reagan was elected governor of California, animator Walt Disney died of cancer, and Brian Wilson, at the age of 24, was the most popular American songwriter of his generation.
I love the colorful clothes she wears and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair.
Good Vibrations took 6 months to record, costing $50,000 for 3.5 minutes of pop bliss.
Of course, then again, Good Vibrations, people have called a pocket symphony. Is that pop music? Is that rock and roll? What is it?
She's giving me the excitations. I'm backing up.
Brian used hashish and amphetamines on a regular basis. He took to recording Good Vibrations in snippets, which he later pieced together. It became his new approach to songwriting.
Because sometimes we would come in, we would play 4 bars of music, and Brian would say, "Thank you, gentlemen," and that was it. Sometimes we'd work, 4, 5, 6 hours at a time.
Tony Asher had written lyrics to the song, but Brian let a skeptical Mike Love write new ones.
Okay, so here, catch. You can come up with something better. We're doing it tonight. I'll see you there,
It was a scary little record to make, But it's okay now. I went through a lot of bullshit over it, It took me on a ride that I didn't want to go on.
In November 1966, Good Vibrations shot to the top of the charts. The Beach Boys edged out the Beatles in a British popularity poll. But at 24, Brian Wilson had written his last number one hit. The song was to be the first track of the next Beach Boys album, Dumb Angel. Brian described the project as a teenage symphony to God. He later changed its name to Smile.
His life was humor, and of course in those days, humor was like passé. I mean, we were all very serious people, and everything was, acid-tinged seriousness. And here's this guy who thinks that, the essence of everything that is good is humor.
I've been in this town so long and back in the city. I've been taken for lost and gone and unknown for a long, long time.
For a collaborator, Brian chose Van Dyke Parks, a sharp-tongued southerner, once described as Edith Sitwell on Speed.
There was an obsession to reject anything that smacked patriotism. The Beach Boys, pan-patriotic, kind of a trans-presidential vibe, was, to me, an ideal platform to talk about what we knew.
I really hear America. I really feel that he was trying to sum up America. He was literally trying to take Mark Twain into rock and roll. And he almost got there. He almost got there.
Under a drug-induced umbrella, life at the Wilsons' home became unreal. Brian's piano sat in a vast sandbox in the living room.
People just wanted to be around Brian. They wanted to get what he had. You can't get what's in there. He was born with what he had.
He was being accepted as just a creative genius, and so that allows you to sort of indulge yourself, and he did.
One observer called it the Mad Hatter's Tea Party. Nights were filled with speed-induced hunts for ping pong tables or telescopes. Brian talked about the importance of health and opened a natural food store on the Sunset Strip called the Radiant Radish.
I mean, this fellow who Paul McCartney and Sir George Martin and John Lennon and Leonard Bernstein call one of the true American treasures is behind the counter selling ginseng and vitamins.
The Beach Boys started their own label, Brother Records, to produce eccentric and often humorous side projects.
I remember Brian saying that he wanted Michael Vasey and myself and him to go to a bar somewhere, and he wanted me to start a fight with somebody in the bar, and he would record it because he thought that'd be very humorous. And I said, well, Brian, what happens, you know, if the fight goes on beyond, you know? It was, he didn't even think of that.
The smile sessions were spontaneous and often surreal. Brian canceled dates due to bad vibes. The other Beach Boys grew frustrated with his strange behavior and even stranger music. Fights became common. Finding his lyrics under constant scrutiny, Van Dyke Parks bowed out. Brian grew paranoid, becoming convinced his house was bugged by his father Murray or by producer Phil Spector.
And he got it to a point where I actually started thinking we were bugged too. So, yes, we had a lot of meetings in the pool, a lot of steam coming up in cold nights.
The world changed in the summer of 1967. The Monterey Pop Music Festival defined San Francisco as the new center for youth culture, with acid rock as its soundtrack. To hippies, the Beach Boys and their Pollyanna message were a good humor hallucination. For Brian Wilson, there was a sense that the parade had gone by. The unfinished Smile project was never released, but fragments of it appeared on later Beach Boys albums and on numerous bootlegs.
It'll never come out. It's just the tapes have been destroyed. They're destroyed.
Darkness to touch, the hour was struck.
Maybe Smile was never meant to be other than what it is. But it certainly, I think, would have clearly been the hallmark pop rock record.
Those words, those genius words, those tormented artist words, they don't really mean anything. Because for 1 year or 5 years or 10 years, he shined like a star and he shined very bright. And people have to remember that part of it because we get caught up in all the American-isms of it.
The emotional centerpiece of Smile was a mournful ballad, Surf's Up. Brian was filmed playing it at home.
I think everything kind of went downhill from there because he just thought, why am I putting everything I have into this when no one's ready for it?
It might have been like a goodbye to a certain part of himself. It was what a song.
I heard the word, wonderful thing, a children's song.
To me, Brian is like Tinkerbell in Peter Pan. He's a light, and if you believe in the light, it shines brighter. And if you don't believe in it, it dims. The light was as bright as it could be, and then almost like turning a switch, he turned it off.
The Beach Boys were Brian's family, but after the Smile fiasco, he no longer played Big Brother. It was now up to the others to lead.
You know, the Beach Boy, the ups and downs and the wars and the peace, you couldn't have that in the regular band. You'd have to be related to do all that.
Personalities pulled the Beach Boys in different directions. Mike Love followed the teachings of Maharishi Mahesh Yogi and practiced transcendental meditation. Al Jardine became a family man. Carl Wilson played mediator, doing whatever it took to keep the band together. He asked Marilyn to build a studio in the living room of Brian's new Bel Air home. They came together to record their next 7 albums there.
She was all right behind it. And I know it was a hardship on her. I know that it destroyed her home life, but it was what was required at the time.
The band hired a manager to update their candy stripe image. Dennis had already embraced alternative cultures and taken in a group of hippie drifters who practiced free love. Their leader was an aspiring singer-songwriter named Charlie Manson. Dennis got the Beach Boys to record one of his songs and tried to sign him to the Beach Boys label.
I just didn't feel good about Charles Manson. He didn't feel like a Brother Records artist to me.
With the Beach Boys recording in his living room, Brian retreated to his bedroom directly upstairs. Occasionally, sounds in the studio would draw him out.
Was something that he really wanted to do, he would come downstairs and participate in it. If he didn't want to, you know, he had a way of, all he had to do is walk upstairs and just completely tune out to everything.
In the late 60s, the Beach Boys produced a string of strong albums that went largely ignored. The number of live bookings for the band shrank.
I was hearing things like, oh, the Beach Boys are not hip, and all that stuff, but I don't think the Beach Boys are supposed to be hip. I think they're supposed to move you emotionally whether you like it or not.
The Beach Boys left Capitol Records amidst a sea of lawsuits and ill will. They shopped for a new label with little success. Warner Brothers finally signed them after the band guaranteed Brian's participation.
Certainly whenever Brian came into the recording situation, everything stopped, whatever was going on. And all ears and eyes were attentive to what Brian might suggest or want to do.
You know, it wasn't always easy being around the guys at that point. So, you know, he would stay in there for as long as his attention span would let him. And then he'd just want to get out. Well, sorry, gotta go to bed.
In the midst of all this, Marilyn gave birth to a daughter, Carney, in April 1968. A second daughter, Wendy, was born a year and a half later. Although Brian loved his daughters, the weight of fatherhood scared him.
He said, I don't want to do to my children what my father did to me, and I don't know any other way. He said, you have to raise them. You have to do it.
I remember being 5 or 6 and her saying, you know, your daddy's not like a lot of other daddies, and he has a drug problem, but he is a musical genius, and you can be proud of that forever.
Brian steadily used cocaine and chain-smoked cigarettes.
I started to see depression towards the end. That's the reason I had to leave, is Brian, it was, you know, that got to that scene where I went up to have one of those meetings and he wouldn't come out of the bedroom.
Father Murray Wilson made matters worse. He had long controlled the publishing rights to his son's songs. In 1969, over Brian's arguments and tears, Murray sold them for $700,000. Brian didn't speak for days.
And he said, you can't sell my songs. And his father said, well, I did, because they're never going to amount to anything. That really threw Brian. I mean, he was depressed. And we're talking going to bed.
In 1999, the catalog's estimated value was $22 million. Brian spent most of the early 70s writing songs the public would never hear.
I'd go up there and I'd be fractured, it'd be so brilliant. But that would be enough for him, the reaction. You know, it went number one in his living room. He's done. The song would disappear.
As Brian receded deeper into depression, the Beach Boys made a comeback after remaking their image. In 1971, the band played legendary shows with the Grateful Dead, headlined Carnegie Hall, and considered changing their name simply to Beach. Rolling Stone magazine wrote, "It's impossible to hear them and not be knocked out."
I'm a cork on the ocean, floating over the...
Brian's main contribution to the Beach Boys' 1972 album Surf's Up was the darkly autobiographical Till I Die. In June of 1973, Murray Wilson died of a heart attack at the age of 55. Dennis and Brian could not bring themselves to attend the funeral. Brian told a reporter, "It's making a man out of me."
Brian loved him, yet he didn't like him. I'm not going to use the word hate because I know he didn't hate him. He loved him, but his father was very frustrating.
Brian expressed suicidal thoughts and threatened to drive his Rolls-Royce off the end of the Santa Monica Pier. Mostly, he retreated into his own world.
Who knew those kind of inner conflicts? You know, so it would just be easier to tune out and to be a recluse or to make people think that you were crazy.
He picks up the tiniest vibrations of negativity and it magnifies itself within him. So from a survival point of view, it's been safer to stay inside.
Brian Wilson would spend most of the next 3 years in bed. For 2.5 years, Brian Wilson stayed in bed, trying to hide from the voices that haunted him.
He'd have a turntable next to his bed, and he would play that song, Be My Baby. And he would play it maybe 100 times a day.
Brian heard Phil Spector's voice. He heard his father Murray's voice. His appetite for food and drugs became endless.
Did you ever try sleeping with one eye open? I mean, that's basically the way I had to sleep each night, wondering what he was doing, what he was up to, who was going to come in the house, who he was going to give money to, who was going to give him drugs.
Brian had moved into the chauffeur's quarters above the garage, where he spent many days locked inside. Those around Brian attributed his problems to substance abuse, not mental illness.
20 or 30 years ago, mental illness was like, oh boy, we can't talk about that. But you can bet your bottom dollar, had he had cancer, they would have shot him up to UCLA real quick.
Marilyn was left raising their 2 daughters on her own.
He was emotionally unavailable. He had too much on his plate. He was not available for his children.
I think one of the only times we ever sat down to have dinner, Mom served steaks, and we sat down and she forgot to give him a fork. And so he said, "Mary, get me a fork." She went to get him a fork. By the time she walked back in, the steak was gone and he was already playing the piano. It was like,
During Brian's retreat, the Beach Boys released no new material. In July of 1974, Capitol Records put out a greatest hits album that shot to number one. Concert audiences swelled. Everyone wanted a new record. The only thing missing was Brian.
Sail on, sail on, sail on.
Over the years, Brian had visited more than 20 therapists. In late 1975, Marilyn sought a more dramatic course of action. Psychologist Eugene Landy was a shrink to the stars, having worked with clients such as Rod Steiger and Alice Cooper. He had also been a consultant on the original Bob Newhart show. He called his unconventional approach milieu therapy.
And Dr. Landy, you know, had a full-time staff at the house 24 hours a day, which turned out to be a nightmare for my children and me. But we did it because we did it for Brian. I mean, we'd do anything for him to help him.
Landy worked at getting Brian off drugs and on a diet. He bullied him, explaining, "There's only room for one crazy person in Brian's head, and that's me." Landy forced Brian out of bed, and within months rushed him back into the studio to record with the Beach Boys.
Back in time with just a rhythm and rhyme, Gregorian chants were a real big thing.
An album and TV special spearheaded the first Brian is Back campaign.
He was back, you know, to a certain extent of as much as they could push him to be back.
I don't know. I sort of been put in the limelight for a while. I was under the lamp, you know, so to speak, you know.
We're singing that same song.
It was good business, but again, some in the band resented the attention lavished on Brian.
So Brian is that resonant genius and teacher, leader harmonically and musically. And the reason I think he's gotten so screwed up at times in the past is because he is that sensitive.
The TV special featured a scene in which Dan Aykroyd and John Belushi forced Brian to go surfing. It was filmed on his 34th birthday.
We're from the Highway Patrol, surf squad. Surfing? I don't want to go surfing. Now, look, you guys, I'm not going. You get your hair wet, you get sand in your shoes. Okay, I'm not going.
Come on, Brian. Let's go surfing now.
Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with us. Come on.
Let's go.
All right. Okay, let's go. Let's go surfing.
Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on.
Brian was petrified of climbing into the water until his full-time therapist wrote on a small piece of paper, "You will not drown. You will live." Signed, Dr. Landy. Brian kept the note in his bathrobe pocket. In November 1976, Brian made his first talk show appearance.
I did my dose of LSD, it shattered my mind, and I, you know, came back, thank God, in I don't know how many pieces.
What made you come back, Brian?
That's a hard question. I probably came back out of will. Just, my name is Wilson, maybe that's where I got the will.
You were in bed for over 3 years, weren't you?
Oh, two and a half, 3 years. I hibernated. It was like, it's like some kind of a Maharishi in the hills, hiding in his bed, snorting cocaine, meditating.
Okay, thank you.
In 1 year, Dr. Landy's bill had grown to $20,000 a month. Marilyn fired him.
Be right back, right after this.
As new Beach Boys material floundered, the band started to market its past.
A lot of anything with the Beach Boys always comes with a certain amount of baggage. And for me as a fan, it's always been trying to rip away the baggage and just get down to the core music.
Lawyers, drugs, and money kept the band on the brink of breaking up. They toured on separate planes. Band members entered the stage from opposite sides, so they never had to speak to one another.
Got into a fire.
The group dragged Brian back on the road. A performing circus bear, said one friend.
It made it a little difficult, you know, because sometimes he would be playing something other than what we were playing.
CBS Records offered the Beach Boys a deal with a condition that Brian Wilson co-write 70% of the material. He cried tears of frustration as he signed the contract. Although he had full-time handlers, Brian slipped back into drug use and overeating. He often ran away from home on binges. Private detectives once found him playing for free drinks in a San Diego piano bar.
He said, "I want to feel what it's like to be a bum, you know, like on the streets and all that." You don't think that was hard to deal with? The final straw was he was so out of it, he didn't know what he was doing anymore. And when Carney was a young girl, he had offered her a drug. And I said, "That's it? Nothing in the world, no matter how much I loved that man, nothing was going to hurt my children and no one. That was it."
On September 15th, 1978, Brian and Marilyn were legally separated. He spent several months hospitalized for drug dependency. For the next 15 years, Brian would rarely see his daughters. The Wilson brothers tried to help. but each was going through a divorce and battling personal demons.
Brian, along with his two brothers, came from the same dysfunctional family. For the other two brothers to be more functional on an emotional level, in my opinion, would be impossible.
Carl played the caretaker, trying to keep the family and the band together.
People don't know what Carl did for Brian. They don't know how much money Carl put out for Brian's health.
He always felt that his mother favored Carl. And that was difficult for Brian.
In his own way, Dennis tried to help. He'd buy a bag of McDonald's hamburgers, giving Brian one for each new song. Brian started living with a nurse he had met while in rehab. He consumed 4 packs of cigarettes a day and the same number of steaks. He ballooned to 325 pounds and took whatever substance he got his hands on. Brian grew increasingly afraid of the water and refused to take showers.
Carl would say, "We've got to go down to the Venice Beach and look for Brian." And we rushed him to the hospital more than once. So I didn't think we were going to lose Dennis, but I thought we were going to lose Brian.
His longtime friends were powerless over Brian's illness.
He just walked straight over to the piano and sat down, and he started playing the intro to one of their hits. He said, "Do you know this song?" "Yeah, Brian, I love that song. It's one of my favorites." "Do you know this song?" "Yeah, Brian, I love this song. I just love this song. Let's play it, you know. Do you know this song?"
The only person who had any success with Brian was Dr. Eugene Landy. The band agreed to force Brian back into his care.
And I think it was Carl that had to say to Brian, "Brian, if you don't do this, you can't be a Beach Boy anymore." Brian was petrified of Landy. And I remember Brian sitting there going, "I can't be a Beach Boy?" I mean, it was just heartbreaking.
On November 5th, 1982, his brothers, his cousin, and his friend fired Brian Wilson from the Beach Boys. Fired from the Beach Boys, Brian Wilson entered an intensive treatment program with Dr. Eugene Landy in January 1983. He went to Hawaii and began a strict regimen of fruit juice and exercise. In 2 months, he was off drugs and had lost 20 pounds.
Brian Wilson is a perfect example of the fact that in my field, I'm an artist.
Landy cut Brian off from everybody. And if you needed to anything to do with Brian, you went to Landy.
He had to have his terms, and that was. But, you know, without him, Brian would probably be dead too.
After 6 months, Brian had lost over 100 pounds, and Landy pronounced him well enough to play with the Beach Boys. On Independence Day, 1983, the original Beach Boys played their last show together.
I knew that Denny would probably never die of old age.
Dennis Wilson, the only real surfer in the Beach Boys, drowned while diving in a shallow harbor. His blood alcohol level was 0.26.
I have had 2 losses in my family in the last 10 years, and it's been hard for me. The first loss was very hard, my father, and then, of course, my brother Dennis. It's hard to lose a brother and somebody who had such a vital, energetic thing about him, and I just don't want to talk anymore about it.
Dennis was so much the balls of the group. You know, he had the look, he had the rebelness. It was a big hole in the Beach Boys when we lost Dennis.
In 1984, Brian was clinically diagnosed as a paranoid schizophrenic and a manic depressive. Doctors also found brain damage from years of drug use. Landy put him on a new cocktail of medicines. Some claimed more to mind control his patient than to medicate him properly.
The biggest challenge for me is to keep my sanity in this world, to keep a sanity going and a logic in my head going. That's real hard for me to do because I'm exposed to a lot of very insane things and things that don't make any sense.
Landy's assistants, known as the Psycho Roadies, attended to Brian around the clock. They screened his calls and videotaped his every action. In 1986, Landy arranged a date for Brian with Melinda Ledbetter, a car dealer who had sold Brian a Cadillac.
It was strange. He had a couple of bodyguards around him, and the whole time they were keeping in contact with Dr. Landy, even up to the goodnight kiss. So it was pretty bizarre.
Landy also worked on getting a solo deal for his client.
I wasn't right into collaboration, but the collaboration that we have going is so strong that I feel this new album ought to skyrocket to the sky, you know? And it'll shoot to the sky in sales.
I was sitting in a crummy movie with my hands on my chin.
In 1988, Brian released his first solo album. It had four producers and cost $1 million to record.
Whatever is going on in his life, he finds a way to make the music express what he needs. And he needed at that time love and mercy.
It received great reviews and peaked at number 54 on the charts. That same year, the California Board of Medical Quality Assurance charged Eugene Landy with several counts of malpractice, which included the illegal prescription of drugs. Landy pled guilty to one count and surrendered his license. He remained, however, Brian's Svengali.
Landy thinks that Brian is the goose that laid the golden egg.
I think Gene thought it was all about Brian. Brian knew that it was all about his music, his brothers, his cousin, and his friend.
The other Beach Boys released the song Kokomo. While Brian's album languished in the charts, Kokomo shot to number one. Although it was based on the sound Brian Wilson created, Mike Love bragged about recording the track without his cousin's help. Under Landy's care, Brian lost touch with the rest of his family.
Landy wouldn't allow him to speak to his children. He could not call them. So Landy created Landy's family. His mother and his family became Brian's family. I mean, how sick is that?
I was very angry because we wanted to see our dad. You know, and he kept brainwashed. I mean, he was brainwashed. Dad was brainwashed into thinking that his family was bad and against him.
I find them to be very people that are very sick. I mean, you know, I mean, I have some pity for them.
Brian began referring to Landy as his partner in life. Landy commissioned a movie script about their friendship and approached Richard Dreyfuss to play him and William Hurt to play Brian.
He doesn't like me to say I can't do this or I can't do that, you know. He says, you can do it. And I say, yes, I can. I get angry too, you know. I find myself doing it. I'm very proud. I wake up the next morning. I say, no, I go to bed that night. And I say, yeah. You know, I say, I did it.
Dr. Landy was excellent in playing the father figure. And he knew enough about Brian, and he knew enough about Brian's fears of his father that he knew pretty well how to control him.
Landy was managing Brian's business affairs, co-writing songs, and singing backup. When questioned on national television about ethical violations, Landy was evasive.
It's a rule that I don't, and I can't explain it to you.
Brian's relationship with Melinda ended when Landy found her questioning his decisions. In 1990, the Wilson family battled back by filing a number of suits and petitions to gain a legal conservatorship over Brian's life. The impetus was the alleged redrafting of Brian's will, in which Landy was named chief beneficiary. In 1991, Brian released a ghostwritten autobiography. Its psychobabble and slanderous tone brought on lawsuits from other Beach Boys and from Brian's mother. Later, in sworn testimony, Brian admitted he never read the book and called it all garbage. A court-approved settlement mandated a 3-year separation between Eugene Landy and Brian Wilson. Landy moved to Hawaii, where he remains a licensed psychotherapist.
Well, I feel thankful. They taught me what the ropes in life, you know. The grim facts of it all is if you don't eat right and exercise, you're not going to get it. You won't make it through.
He really believes the testament. Do unto others, turn the other cheek. In fact, Brian has turned the other cheek so many times, I think he's got whiplash. He would rather hurt himself than hurt another person.
During Landy's regime, Wendy and Carney had virtually no contact with their father. In that time, they became 2/3 of the pop group Wilson Phillips and had 3 number one hits of their own. They used their music to reach out to their father.
We created this song to like speak to him and tell him that we wanted to see him again, you know, and talk to him.
Right. We were really trying to get through to him, and we were saying in the chorus, how can we be like enemies when we're only flesh and blood, and what does it take to make your heart bleed, Daddy? Aren't we enough?
Without Landy, Brian Wilson had to find a new life, and that meant looking at his old one. In the early 90s, with Eugene Landy out of his life, Brian Wilson's troubles did not stop. His life decisions were handled by a court-appointed conservator. In 1992, Brian started dating Melinda again after she almost ran him over in traffic. She set about helping Brian make amends with his past.
Melinda said, "I will bring back the family again. Brian, the children will have their father again." You know, so that's how they have gotten back into his life.
In 1997, Brian wrote a song for his daughters with Pet Sounds collaborator Tony Asher.
I think that he needed to know that we, you know, we forgive him. We don't hold anger because we know that he was going through a lot. He just wasn't capable of being there, you know?
It was tough for Brian to get back into it, and it was tough for everybody else because they were, and still are, afraid of having him out of their life.
In 1991, Brian filed a $100 million lawsuit against Irving Almo, the company that had purchased Brian's 1960s songs from his father. They eventually settled for $10 million. In 1993, Mike Love sued Brian over songwriting royalties for 39 compositions he claimed to have co-written, but for which he was never paid.
It's a Mike going after what he thinks is due that his uncle, Brian's father, caused. It's not a personal thing against Brian. Mike loves Brian.
Mike won the case and within weeks was again writing songs with Brian.
I do again believe that in his own way, he loves his cousin. And I know Brian loves him. I mean, even after the lawsuit, $5 million, okay, well, to Brian, it's not always about the money.
In Brian's absence, the Beach Boys had become Mike Love's band and a profitable touring business. During ill-fated reunions, relations between Brian and the group never healed. In 1995, Brian and Melinda wed. To find peace, they bought a part-time residence in St. Charles, Illinois. The man who invented the California sound would spend much of his time in America's heartland.
The sad thing is Brian's music now is more rejected in California than it's accepted. So the Midwest is kind of an escape for him, because here, it's still an ideology and it's still a dream that we all share.
The couple also adopted two baby daughters, Daria and Delaney.
And what he has now is he has emotional support from his family, his friends.
He seemingly is in a fairly good place, but that's not the real Brian Wilson. That's a Brian Wilson that's become complacent and basically surrendered. That's the surrendered Brian Wilson.
Brian built a studio with producer Joe Thomas, a Nashville veteran and former pro wrestler once known as Buddy Love. In 1998, Brian released a second solo album, Imagination. In December 1997, Brian's mother, Audrey, died of heart failure. Brian told a reporter, "I lost her in my head before she actually died."
When I heard you crying.
2 months later, 51-year-old brother Carl Wilson succumbed to lung cancer.
How could I have left you alone?
I just jam it out of my mind. I say, oh, f*** it. You know, I try not to think about it, yeah.
I will always believe that they loved each other to death, that they just had a really hard time showing it.
It's funny or ironic or whatever the word is to think that he would be the one that survived. But, you know, he's so strong.
Brian had always hated touring, but in 1999, he gave his first ever solo tour to critical and popular acclaim.
There's a world where I can go and tell.
We've more or less decided that if he's going to be in the music business, that there's a certain way that you stay in the music business. And it's not by making an album every 10 years and just throwing it out.
The man deserves some peace. And I think he shouldn't be pushed. I think he should just do what makes him feel good. Why should he be pushed?
He's still a true innocent. It's a damaged innocent right now. When he steps out of the other side of the glass in a recording studio, it's not going to be Brian.
The story ended. He's alive and well and happily married and having children. But somehow we're stuck there, not him. We have to stop asking him for something. It's like he's already given it. And if he wants to give more, great. The choice is his.
He said, my work is done. I think I did my work. I did my work. When I was very young, I worked hard. I did a lot of good work.
There'll be nights when he'll be sitting down at the piano, I'll have gone to bed, and I'll hear this stuff that I can't believe. And I'll come downstairs and I'll say, what is that? And he'll go, I don't know. Don't you think you need to record it? He goes, nah.
God only knows what I'd be without.
God only knows what I'd be without.
And God only knows.
The whole world could go away when we were singing on a microphone. The world could disappear. It was just amazing what happens when you really want to do something.
What I'd be without.